This episode of Orange is the New Black is brought to you by Tweaked Audio. To get awesome headphones, go to tweakedaudio.com and use the coupon code SOUTHGATE to get 30% off, free shipping, and a lifetime warranty. Or you can get there through the link on our website, southgatemediagroup.com.
Another year's gone by. I'm so glad you're with me. The way you lift me up with the love you give me. It's good to know that you'll be mine when days are blue. Oh, what a dream come true.
Welcome to the Orange is the New Black podcast. I am Rob Southgate. With me is
Martha Southgate.
And we are talking season 6, episode 9, Break the String.
Yep.
Martha, you want to give us a description?
While Daddy buys time with Barb, Daya looks for new ways to bring in Oxy. Black Cindy's guilt takes a toll on her body, and Red acquires a powerful ally.
Okay, before we get into it, on YouTube, we had a comment that they found it hilarious that we call her Big Cindy when her name is Black Cindy.
Yeah,
And I don't know where we got Big Cindy instead of Black Cindy, but somewhere all the way back in like season 2, I think somebody called her Big Cindy and we were confused, or could just be that we never figured it out.
Okay, but we have decided to just call her Cindy.
Right, she's Cindy.
So are we the only ones who call her that?
I kind of think so.
Okay, well, I don't approve.
Okay, well,
we'll just call her Cindy.
Yes.
Because I don't want to call her Big Cindy.
So
no one else is.
What part of it do you want to start with? There was a lot here.
Let's start with Tasty's storyline. We'll start with Cindy since we're already talking about
her.
So we've got
those are two storylines that intersect. So let's start with Tasty's.
Okay.
So first of all, the last time we saw Tasty was when she did the interview.
Yeah.
So in this one, she is talking to Cindy and she's saying, you know, does this look, what did she say? Like, does this
look? She was talking about her hair because she has a her trial deposition.
Right. But she was saying, like, does this look like somebody who is falsely accused?
Right.
Cindy thinks that she's going to do another interview.
Right.
And Tasty's like, no, because Caputo is leaving. They pushed it all up, so we've got to have this trial,
yes,
this deposition, and
that made Cindy's guilt go crazy
nuts. Yes, immediately she started going,
yeah,
oh, it's killing her.
Yeah,
the thing is, well, I don't know if we should get to that already, but Cindy's,
anyone who's listening has already watched the episode.
Right. True. True.
It's so not it doesn't like matter. You're giving a spoiler.
But Cindy's guilt, you know, if we go back to the root of why this is, like, Cindy in this one is telling Tasty, I'm a bad person. She hasn't told her yet, but she's like, I'm a bad person because she's feeling so much guilt and she's having all this back pain and all these pains. And if you go back to when this all happened, yes, she lied. Mm-hmm. Yes, she is covering this up. But the reason is she is genuinely in fear of getting killed.
Yes.
So it's not like when she said, you know, she reveals to Tasty that she has a daughter.
Right. And she never told the father.
Right. She's like, I'm a bad person.
And her daughter doesn't know she's her mother. She thinks that she's her sister.
Right. Right. It's different. Yes. It's the same mechanism that she used. It's the same lie tactic that she used. Mm-hmm. But she wasn't in mortal danger.
Right.
You know, she just didn't want to give up her life, which
is why she
lied.
Inconvenient, or she might have thought that, you know, she was giving her daughter a better life doing it this way.
Right.
I don't know, but
the reality is she is in fear for her life, which is why she lied here. And yes, she shouldn't be lying. She should come forward, which is why she's suffering. But I just want to be clear about that, because here she's saying this, and I could see how if you don't think about that, you might be thinking, yeah, Cindy, just tell. I want her to tell, but I do feel for her.
Yes, she's putting herself and Suzanne in danger.
And Tasty.
Well, I'm saying if she tells the truth, she's putting herself and Suzanne
in danger, yes.
Right in the line of fire.
Right.
And then if she doesn't tell, Tasty's going down.
I think at this point she's putting herself more than she is Suzanne, because I think Suzanne, they realize she's a nutter. And she could be convinced, you mm-hmm. know? I think Cindy is the only one who's really on the hot seat with guards if she admits it. But, you know, I think we're at a point when we're looking at how these guards are acting and all the stuff that's going on. You know, it could be, if she just comes forward, that there will be an intervention that would help. I don't know. They're a privatized prison still.
Okay, but the problem is it's her and against. Suzanne against the entire system.
Yeah.
And the fact of the matter is, why would they believe them?
But that entire system is not a federal system. It is a privatized
right.
prison.
Who has every reason to cover up and ignore and whatever else. And if they are saying, oh, but the guards killed Piscatella,
right,
then they could just as easily say, well, you're just trying to get your friend off.
Right.
You're just trying
right,
to.
Right, right. No, it's
so, I mean,
a bad
the chances
scene.
Of them being heard and believed are very slim. If they are heard and believed, then they very much run the risk of having an accident, if
right.
you will, in prison. Because they always say it's very easy for us to make it look like an accident. And they could die in here and no one would.
Right.
No
well, I mean, they're already suspect. Beating them.
And there don't seem to be any repercussions for that.
No,
so
not at all.
Why would we believe that Cindy and Suzanne would be okay?
Yeah.
Now, does that make it right?
No, not at all.
I don't, you know, it's really a, it's
I,
a hard
I think this
call.
Is the kind of story that a show about prison can tell, but it's not one that we have a paradigm to work within other than when you think about it as a prison.
Right.
Because if this was outside of a prison, you'd say, no, absolutely, walk away from this. Or they can't.
Mm-hmm.
Cindy can't. But she's watching her friend Tasty essentially get life mm-hmm. because of this. It's frightening. So, okay.
Now,
so,
what could happen is Cindy can get out.
Okay.
And then once she's out, she could say
she could tell the truth.
This happened, and she we
and I
need
didn't
a,
say anything. Got a fear.
We need an appeal. You know, if she can right. file an appeal, we need a retrial or something like that.
The problem is, I don't know if that's possible. If they make their decision on Tasty, unless they have irrefutable evidence that this happened, it's just Cindy's word against it.
Right.
If she says it while she's in the system, while this is all still going on, an investigation can happen right there mm-hmm. and it might actually prove out for her.
I'm just saying, if I can see it playing out that way, if Cindy thinks I can't tell until I'm safely out of there.
Do you think we'll get resolution to this season?
I don't.
Because, I mean, really,
we only have 3 more episodes. Right?
And if I remember right,
former.
If I remember right, there's only one more season that is mm-hmm. for sure.
Right.
And I could see, I mean, these are people on here are getting other gigs. It's such a popular show, but I could see it ending at 7 seasons.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, they've already set us up by having Piper talk about how she's going to write her book. It makes a perfect entry into season 7 being the final season. Mm-hmm. And maybe
that's when I think they would wrap it up.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Maybe we don't see, we never see them get back to camp. That's not going to happen. So next season happens right here in Max. The Tasty storyline gets resolved in the 7th season. Now we're saying all this, and what's going to be funny is we're going to get to like episode 11 or 12.
And it's going to be resolved.
And it's going to be resolved, and we're going to look like episode 12, they're back at camp.
Right.
Like,
it's like, oh, wow, you guys were way off.
Completely wrong.
But
that would not be
I
unlike
think we're
us.
Often wrong even when we watch the episode that we know, and we know it. You
oh,
know
yes.
what I mean?
Well, the fact that we called her Big Cindy for 5 seasons? We've got problems. So
I don't know.
Okay, so Tasty has the deposition with...
Did they call her Big Tasty or is that
Goldberg? No, that is Goldberg's. You keep asking that.
I'm thinking maybe I was just getting it from a different character.
You're going to get all goofed up. So they have the deposition with Caputo. Caputo defends her.
He was so sweet.
He says great stuff about
her.
And
he was being honest. I mean, those were real things.
Well, like when he was so proud of her.
Yes.
When he says she got this job.
Because she won the
mock
yes.
job fair. He was so proud. And then that lawyer tries to spin it. That there's something fishy going on.
That he should have feared for his life because they were threatening him and everything. And he's just sitting there like, because he
has to say, yes, that did happen.
But it didn't. It doesn't mean that he believed them, that they would really kill him. You know what I mean?
That's what's tricky about lawyers and court. Technically, you have to answer the question, which is why your lawyer tries to coach you, like, if they ask this, you need to say this, mm-hmm. because he's not allowed to say, well, wait a minute,
right.
let me tell you how this all plays out. No, black and white,
mm-hmm.
is this what happened? And he has to say yes.
Right.
You know, unless they say, the judge says, you know, final statement or whatever, or would you like to rebut that, or
you just make, you don't know anything.
Well, they didn't ask any of that.
You've never been in a court. You don't know anything. You're just making this all up. You watch TV.
Okay. And there are lawyers on TV.
You have no idea.
I saw a commercial for Boston Legal one time, and I think this is what happened.
Yeah.
I saw the movie From the Hip with Judd Nelson.
My Lord.
That was a good movie.
Whoever has even heard of Judd Nelson,
and
though.
They did a whole, was it Judd Nelson?
Yes.
Yeah. See?
Okay, besides me. So
but did
else?
You see that movie?
Yes.
That was a good movie.
Okay, but it was 800 years ago.
I like that movie. And he got disbarred in that. And that's when I learned what disbarred was.
That was the first time?
I was like 16. How would I know? I didn't have a criminal past like you.
No, I watch lots of things that tell me
well,
what disbarred
I
means.
Didn't watch those. I was too busy. At that time, I would have been watching like, oh boy. No, and not even at that time. Because I watched The Bionic Man. I wasn't
okay,
watching courtroom
I'm
going to
talk
dramas.
About this episode. I don't care.
I did watch Cagney and Lacey, but they didn't really go into court stuff. I did like that.
My hand is up.
I watched Give Me a Break. That had none of
the
this.
The hand is up. All right. We're talking about Tasty. So it's not looking good. The deposition did not go well.
No.
And she had already pled guilty to part of it, too. So they said, it's on record. You can't...
Well, she pled guilty to inciting the riot, which she...
No,
she's...
to...
yes.
That.
And she's still...
Yeah, I guess that.
And she is guilty of that. She's not denying that. She's saying, I had nothing to do with this guy getting killed.
Right.
I had nothing to do with the violence.
Although she bloodied his nose.
Right.
So that's... It's just not looking good.
No.
All right. And in the meantime, Cindy's got an ulcer and her back hurts and she's just miserable.
That scene with her and Flocka doing the radio thing.
Yeah, that was
fantastic.
That was unbelievable. And she wrote the letter. Hello. She wrote the letter and then read it as if it wasn't her.
No, that was great. She pulls it out of her sock and she's like, oh, hey. And she throws it in the box. Look at this one looks interesting. And she reads that and Flocka, I would suffocate myself if I was that woman. That's what she said. And Cindy went nuts.
And Cindy pushed the table into her.
I love in this scene though, when she goes, something about her being a bitch. And she goes, hey, language. And Lucy goes, no, Betty White said that on Hot in Cleveland. It's okay. Who uses, you make fun of me for my reference. Who makes Hot in Cleveland their touchstone?
I don't know. And Betty White. Luscek does.
That's amazing.
All right. Is there any more about Tasty?
I wonder if Luscek wants to be a podcaster because really.
Oh my God, I would love it.
He fits the mold.
He fits all of it. Okay. Is there more about Tasty?
I don't think so. Other than she had that scene in the library with Cindy. And Cindy is like, I thought Cindy was totally going to tell her.
Yeah.
I totally thought it. And then she tells this other roundabout way.
And then tells and her says, she's I'm not sorry. A good person.
And Tasty's like, look, this is life. This is how it happens. Which is kind of how Tasty looks at this. Mm-hmm. I think that if Cindy tells her the truth, Tasty will be upset. But I also think that she'd be like, now, at least now you're telling the truth.
Yeah.
And I understand why you had to do this. Like, she's pretty level-headed. I'm not talking about Cindy being level-headed. But Tasty's pretty level-headed. I mm-hmm. think that it would hurt and she'd get upset, but it wouldn't be like, you know, tear the walls down. I'm furious. I think she'd go.
I understand. She'd understand.
I think she'd understand. And come forward now so I can get out of this.
Exactly.
Okay, moving on. We had Red.
Red, who's now fully bonded with Carol.
So she had her new hair. There
were, when you know Red is always going to, she always ends up at the top.
Even when you go back to a couple seasons ago when she was torn down.
Yes, she still managed. And then last season
where she's like, gets scalped. And
yeah.
She still
manages to get back up there.
And here, she got that haircut. I think her hair looks great.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think they like it looks, it's stylish.
Well,
like,
it's much better than the bald with the hole, yeah. with the red scabs all over it or whatever those were.
And she does that Russian stuff. She says that Russian saying, and I love
Carol's response.
I don't even know what you said, but I get the meaning. Yeah, and then she moves like, that other girl out. And she's like, you're playing with me. And yeah. I love the look on Red's face because it's like, you're playing with me. I think Red's face was how long before I get to say, you're playing with me. Yeah,
that's coming.
It's coming.
Yeah, they don't know. They don't know what they've got on their hands.
And I think that those two women have run this, mm-hmm. but I think
their time is
well, I think up. If you look at all the people that have come from
the camp, yeah.
That's where all the trouble's starting.
Yes.
It's a different type of trouble than they're used to because they've got their gangs and they have their fights and they do whatever. And this is like a shift in the culture is happening. I think that
what they didn't expect, the culture at camp, because of Caputo and Luscek and some of these, the people that they had surrounding them, actually listened to them.
Yes.
And treated them like equals in a lot of ways and in a lot of ways respected them and gave them power and and empowered them to think they could actually accomplish things. And so what's happening in Max now is you have people like Piper who is going, all right, dude, I've got something on you. You're going to give me kickball. Which and I'm going to make something happen. You've got Gloria saying, you suck at this thing. Let me teach the class.
Right.
Like there's a shift in the power and the Max people don't have that sense of,
no, they have gangs.
I can take this place over. Whereas the blue camp
versus
people,
orange versus,
but the camp
brown.
People all feel like I have every
right.
to take this over. Like I have we need this. Oh, all we have to do is make it happen. And it's a different culture than anything that they've experienced at Max.
Yeah. Yeah. And they don't like this culture. They don't like this, like, you know, we're against you because you wear this color.
Right.
They're not down with it. Gloria's whole thing fighting that is definitely going to be a problem.
Yeah.
For them. And I loved this. I loved when she's dancing with Luscek and he gets aroused,
if you will. Yeah.
And that was great. Then she's like, is it, when she's talking to Blanca and she's like, was it like a hate
fear one?
And they're fear.
And then she's like, oh no, that's a real one.
He actually likes you.
Yeah. And then she's telling her it's because she's got a good butt.
It's her superpower.
Like, you have your superpower as your nice butt.
And then she tried to use that, but it worked, I think.
She tried to use that butt?
Yes. Oh. But what's her name? Zirconia.
Like as in cubic zirconia.
Who, now they've got a problem here. Zirconia is becoming a little bit more prominent character and has been, you know, having some interesting stuff going on. She was not one of the tight camp girls.
Right.
And because she likes Luzcheck.
Mm-hmm. She's jealous.
Right. So she puts Badison on this scene.
Yes.
Badison then threatens Gloria. And I mean, that was like awful.
Yeah.
What did she say she was going to do to her? It was like, cut your eyeball out or something. It was like, what the hell? It was a nasty thing.
Her thyroid.
Her thyroid. Same difference.
Not really.
Not really. But still, I don't want to get my thyroid cut out.
No.
Yikes.
Mm-mm.
So yeah, there's definitely a shift in the culture, but there's growing pains. And Badison is a big problem.
Mm.
And then I think Carol is a bigger problem than Barb is going to prove to be.
Right.
And I think the reason for that is what we saw with Nikki and Barb. Although, let's go back.
Mm-hmm.
I think that was what they were setting up for. But if we go back, when we saw the flashback of them, it was mentioned that they lured the sister out and killed her,
mm-hmm.
that it was Barb that did the killing. Carol just lured her.
Mm-hmm.
If that's the case, we're seeing this side of Barb and thinking, she's not so bad. She's just in this bad situation. Maybe that's not so true.
Right.
Maybe Carol, and Carol is definitely a psycho,
mm-hmm.
but maybe Barb's not so nice.
Not so well balanced.
Yeah.
No, and she's a druggie, so.
Although she's trying to get clean.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Because we had that scene that, so she gets poisoned in
Nikki
this episode.
Nikki and Blanca were in the hospital.
Right, but wait, before that, Daddy poisoned her.
Oh, yeah.
Gave her something bad.
Powdered.
That, yeah, made her freak the hell out. Yeah,
and she said, well, she didn't poison her.
No,
No, she said.
It was on purpose. But
she said she had to do something to get her high. And she said, I knew based on her past, like what she could handle. And she said, if anyone was going to survive it, it was going to be her.
Right, but that stuff that she was giving her was like this old batch that did this to other people. So, I mean, it wasn't that she was poisoning her to take her out.
She knew she would overcome it.
Right. But they pulled.
I am not saying in any way that what she did was right.
Right.
I am simply saying that you said she was seeking to poison her. She was not.
No,
she was trying to get her high, and she knew no one else here could withstand this without dying.
See, I was also thinking that it was a way to get her off her back for a little bit, not just the high thing, but get her into, you know, she probably knew that she's going to end up in the medical wing. That's what I'm thinking. Mm. But I might be wrong. But anyway,
I thought she said that at one point that would get her out of here so she could think.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, I think she said that, actually.
So Blanca gets taken out early.
She got booted because she was the healthiest of the hospital patients.
And she's like, I've got internal bleeding here.
Right.
But they pull her out. They put Barb in. And the Barb-Nikki scenes, absolutely some of my favorite scenes of the season.
Oh, yeah. That was a great scene.
That scene with the two of them, when she's like, you know, hey, ninth time's the charm. Nikki's tried to get off drugs eight times. When she said, you know, last time I was here, she's like, what? You were here? She goes, man, I got to really lighten up. I'm missing things that are happening. And Nikki's like, yeah, I was here. So, yeah. And then she told that story about how she wasn't on drugs until after Frieda betrayed them.
Yeah.
And so she said, I never touched my stuff until after that point. So we're looking at her as a druggie, but she wasn't.
Right. But now it's been 30 years.
Right.
So she kind of really is.
But she was able to turn down.
Yeah.
Which I don't think if she really couldn't kick it, that she could turn it down that quickly.
And Nikki told the story about when she said she got clean the first time. She said that she got sober the next day because.
Did she say she slept with the guy and then she gave
was like,
him,
I'm gay. And she's like,
I'm gay.
But I woke up with the sister and the brother.
And I gave him my Beanie Babies.
And I gave up my Beanie Baby collection.
She's like, that doesn't sound so
bad. And slept with a guy. And she's like, I got sober the next day because she was like, I realized I had a problem. Yeah.
She goes, well, that doesn't sound so bad. And Nikki goes, I had the tie-dye Jerry Garcia. And she's going through these Beanie Babies.
And we used to sell them.
Yes.
And oh my God, people were crazy. Princess Diana. They wanted the Princess Diana and the, oh my gosh. Yeah. That was,
I bet there's still people out there that are collecting them.
I don't know.
Because they still sell them. You still see them at the stores. I think the craze is obviously done, but I bet there's still plenty of collectors.
I don't know.
You know,
I don't really want to know.
We were just at a camp and they had a whole display of Beanie Babies, and now they have the ones with the weird eyes, and I don't know. I don't know.
Whatever. All right. So, where were we?
Okay. So we talked about
Piper. Let's talk about
another great Piper episode.
Yeah. Let's talk about so Kickball, she needed her signatures. She wasn't getting them. She only had three. And she went to Carol and asked.
Wait, I like how she says she has four. She had three. And Alex says, I'll sign up. She's like, so now you have four. You're a quarter of the way there. She's like, I forged your signature. Yeah.
We're married now. We're engaged now. I can do that. That's legal.
And she goes like, well, I'm not going to be much help with my R. But she goes, yeah, so I still need 14
players. So she went to Carol. Carol gave her permission to talk to to recruit other girls. And she talked to.
Yeah, and we also found out Carol doesn't like Piper.
Oh, no. And Madison hates her, too. But on a scale of 1 to Derek Jeter.
She's trying to do things. I'm the one that does things.
Beth, the baby killer or whatever, she took her to church
that's an awfully long name to put on a jersey, right, a kickball jersey.
To the Bible study thingy.
Yes.
And where she met up with Reyes.
This was a great scene.
And they became buddies. I loved that.
It was a great scene. When they walked in, there was the tension. Mm-hmm. And see, she's right. Our first encounter with Reyes, it wasn't until she was forced into that gangish leader role. Yeah,
And then underwear.
It was like, I have to do this.
Yeah.
And that caused all the trouble for her.
Yeah.
And when Piper gave her that Maya Angelou quote, I thought that was really well done. It was a great quote to use. And
Reyes says,
I don't hate that.
I don't hate that. Yeah. I love that.
And I thought it was great when she had to interpret the Bible verse when she was up there and she was like, this is BS and all that. And she's like, she starts going back. Well,
and I like that the woman didn't ever challenge her. She just stood there and let her keep processing until she got to the point where she was like, oh, I get it now. But because she was in the church thing with Beth, they got all the signatures they needed, but they were from D block.
Yes.
And then Carol found out that they were from D block. And said,
and she got all ticked and she put all her
now
girls.
Now we need a new team because we're going to go head to head with them. And so then she put Madison in charge. Ben Piper didn't care. She smiled.
So who's going to stab the kickball?
I don't know.
Is it going to be Carol again?
I don't know.
Because you know, even though we're talking about season 7, the kickball game has got to happen in this season.
Yeah.
And my bet, if I had to guess how the season's going to end, is going to be the last episode of the season is going to be the kickball game, and it's going to be all hell is going to break loose. That's where somebody's going to get hurt. It's going to end up being a very bad thing for some of the characters, and that's going to lead us into season 7, where our final arc is going to involve
Tasty.
That's
your prediction?
This is my prediction.
Mark your words.
I'm not marking my words because I am pretty wrong on this show. I think I know what I'm talking about. And then the next episode, like all of it goes away and it's like, oh.
Now we're talking about Red, but then we switched gears. But Red had her son come visit.
Oh, I forgot.
And they said that he told her that the dad was with another woman.
Yeah.
And that's why the kids have been avoiding her and he's been avoiding her. And Red is not happy. At all.
No. Well, especially if you think about earlier in the season when she had that realization that the only family I have is you guys.
Right.
You know, my family. And she's professing her love for them and all this. And they're all
they've
like
all moved
on, her.
On without her. The other thing that we haven't talked about was Daya and Daddy. she's trying to get the drugs in to get Daddy back on in good graces, and she's trying to use Alita to do it. Well,
this broke my heart. So first she tells Alita no, or no, Alita tells
says
her
no,
no. And you think, okay, she's trying to put this together, and she's with Hopper.
She's with the CEO, and she's living in his house with him and his grandma.
Right, because she got evicted.
Yes.
And the woman she was with is like, nope, you're not staying here.
Mm-hmm.
So she's living with her.
With him.
With him.
And the grandma.
And where
she... And he's kind of treating her like a kept woman. Like, he left for work, and he's like, okay, so you'll make dinner, and you make sure it's not too spicy for grandma, and... You know, like he's right. kind of.
He wasn't doing that, but at that moment when he did that, it was like, oh, okay, so you're letting her live here
with
but
conditions.
You own her.
Yes, exactly.
That was how it felt, which she doesn't react well to stuff like that.
No.
And this is where it broke my heart. She goes right to Daya and is like, if I have to be, you know, basically I'm going to be your drug mule.
Yes. And we're going to do it a different way this time because we're not going to be stupid.
No, but
again, I mean, they are because they're doing it, but they're, but yeah, she said we need to do a new.
So new are we going to end up with Alita back in prison?
There's no way she's not.
Boy.
I can't imagine how she's going to keep herself out.
I want her to, though.
I do too. And
I know we're not going to have a happy ending with all these characters. It's just never going to happen. No. A lot of them are going to stay in prison. Some are going to die.
Mm-hmm.
This is one where she's one of the few that we've seen get out.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Tasty got out and she got bounced right back in.
Yeah.
I don't want that to be a repeat. You know, I want maybe her to get involved in this and then back out before she does it, before something happens. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I'm anxious to see what the plan is because she... The first plan involved coyote urine, and
oh right, because the dogs won't smell
Alita,
it.
Alita, it didn't seem to go along with that one too much, especially because she had to start wearing underwear. But
you're gonna make me start wearing underwear.
But I can't imagine what her new plan is because she was like, "We're not doing it that way. We're gonna be smarter."
Yeah.
I'm trying to think who else are we missing? We've talked about Piper
and Alex, Madison,
Nikki and Blanc Gloria, and Flocka and Tasty and Cindy.
Yeah, we haven't seen Doggett. We haven't seen there's a lot of them we haven't seen, but Doggett's storyline was happening. She hasn't been around and Frida wasn't in this one.
I like that. There's one CO who is not into the game.
Right. He's the one that was the Christian. He was the one that when they had their thing, he was like a little Kirk Cameron-y about stuff, but then he played along.
Mm-hmm.
And now it's not that he's being, you know, religious about it. He's just like, although the CO that he's partnered with, you know, shut the fire truck or whatever.
She's hilarious.
What
freight
the,
train?
What the freight train?
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, I really like her, but she's playing this game. It does make her kind of awful, which is too bad. Cause I think that might be an environmental thing that's caused her to like fall into this.
Right.
She's not hitting the inmates. She's not doing any of that stuff. We haven't seen her do anything except be very involved in this game, and that means you're thinking of them as subhuman.
Yes.
Which now I don't like you as much.
Mm-hmm.
So,
true fact.
Yeah. And right. Then the last thing we saw, we got one more thing. Well, Fig and Caputo had their great scene.
We did. Fig and Caputo,
that
yeah.
was a great scene with
I
the
love
two of
that.
Them.
So she's been practically living at his apartment or his house because she's like, well, why travel back and forth and whatever? And so she keeps, and then she's like, well, it's like the last 5 days of camp. You're best friends and you swear you'll see each other for the rest of your lives. You know, you'll talk to each other for the rest of your lives. And she said 1 week away from you and I'll be back to normal.
One of the best lines is when he's like, you're softening. You've been in public with me. You sat across from me at a Five Guys.
Yeah.
You had a conversation with me at a Five Guys. That was
hilarious.
She's like, oh.
I like them together.
I that scene was so well written. It was so great. And that was leading up to when he went to the deposition. And then at the end, though, Beth, is that her name? I can't remember her name.
If you could tell me where you're at. The Beth is the baby killer.
Okay.
Linda?
Linda.
Okay.
Linda shows up and she's like, you know, you're betraying, what is it? MCL? MLC?
Okay, we'll go with that.
Whatever it is.
MCL.
You're betraying them because you're owned by them. You are them. And then he goes, I'm not. I quit.
Mm-hmm.
Good.
Okay,
don't go to that Missouri prison where the wardens kill themselves.
So first of all, he quit. Now he's got to find a job. And we have to find out what Fig is going to think now that he's not leaving. Going. Is she going to want to still be in a relationship with him?
Right. Is she going to get deeper in a relationship? Is she going to dump him? I mean, what's she going to do?
Right.
But I really don't think I think that she is going to be happy because of how she reacted when they went on their date and she got so mad at him, like, now you're leaving.
Right.
And now he can say, look, let this be what it is.
Yeah.
I think that's how he's going to take it too. Like, let's see if this works out, but I'm not going.
Yeah.
I'm here. If it doesn't work, it doesn't work, but I'm here. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where it's going. And I hope.
Mm-hmm.
I like them together. I thought that scene was so great.
Mm-hmm.
And then when Linda showed up and he quit, I thought that was a great scene too. I think this has been a super, super strong season for the Caputo character.
Yeah, I agree.
You know?
I agree.
I think it was shaving that mustache helped.
He's looking good.
And he had the side boob shirt on.
He did have his boob shirt on,
which is so great. Maybe that's what he'll do. He'll just put himself full time into a side boob.
Side boob.
Yeah. Phrasing.
It could happen.
Is that it?
Yeah.
All right. I'm going to do a little bit of the business. Definitely follow us on Facebook. Look up Orange is the New Black podcast. Follow us on Twitter at Orange Podcast. We also have a website, southgatemediagroup.com/Orange is the New Black podcast. You can find us there. And if you can't find us there, just go to Southgate Media Group and look at the directory of podcasts and you'll find us. Let's see what else. You can leave us a message at the website. There is a voicemail on there. So if you want to leave us a message, that would be awesome. We'll play it on the show unless it's something completely horrible. And then we'll be like, okay, we'll just play it for ourselves. And what else? At the top of the show, I mentioned Tweaked Audio. If you need headphones, you want some good headphones, that Tweak deal is amazing. I think I only mentioned the 30% off thing, but it's 30% off, free shipping, and a lifetime warranty, which is a real thing. So if those ever get damaged, they'll send you a new pair. Just use the coupon code Southgate, SOUTHGATE. I'm done. Oh, if you want to send us an email, send it to southgategroup@gmail.com. We will answer that. That's it. Martha, do you have any final thoughts?
No, I'm good.
All right, let's get to that next episode. Inmates, back to yourselves.